can't say it's really far, but what they're pushing for a release every 2 weeks, so it's coming along nicely. When is the 1.0 prime time ready for production? I don't know. And I don't know if anyone could give you a straight answer on that.
Yeah, I mean, you could already do simple stuff with it, right?
Right. Now, my purpose for being here tonight is to give you exposure to this and let you know this is what's coming down the pipeline. So you don't have to worry about learning React and Vue and Angular. And
so don't forget the program. Just remember this is awesome.
Exactly.
Keep working. Right. Keep going to work.
Yeah, keep going to work. Right.
This guy said I didn't have to do React anymore.
You should just stop production right now and wait for this to come.
I needed the whole repo.
So many people are worried, is this going to be the silver light or the second coming of silver light? First of all, it is not like silver light. It's not a plug-in. We're talking about web assemblies that are being utilized here. Second of all, it is different in the sense that it's open source. Yeah, granted, Silverlight was also open source, but it just didn't get the community support. So if you're really a diehard fan of Blazor as it is right now and you're willing to use it, it is out on GitHub. You do have access to the source code. So you can continue supporting it if need be, hypothetically, if it ever gets dropped.
Or even if Blazor doesn't succeed, WebAssembly could, and then something else, Microsoft might come out with something else.
Right. So and again, to your point, let's say Blazor is no longer supported. Well, WebAssembly is supported by all the major browsers, right? And I highly doubt, I can't see that coming, where they're going to drop support for that in the near future, all four of them.
This time next year, there'll be like 8 products that do exactly what they're
saying.
With its own syntax.
This seems to be following like a lot of the conventions of these JavaScript frameworks as far as rendering things.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, that's huge.
Because you had mentioned TypeScript, and this is a lot of, it sounds like it's doing a lot of the same thing TypeScript was meant to do.
Well, not quite, because TypeScript, what it was, you took JavaScript, you compiled it, and what did you end up with in the end?
JavaScript.
Right? It was just better formatted, better written JavaScript in the end. Whereas this, we're talking about something that is, we're talking directly to the browser, low-level binary. Well, it's bytecode, essentially. It gets interpreted into, or compiled by the browser. But essentially, it's a lower, you're compiling to a lower level as opposed to an interpreted language. So it's compiled. It is not interpreted.
Does it perform better? Have you heard any metrics on that?
As you can see right now, it is not a huge performance gain.
Well, I mean, like in the browser,
for your end users?
They're working on that. There are things that need to be stripped out. So, right now it's linking a lot of the libraries. So libraries that you will not be using, they will eventually get stripped out. So it's an active, in-progress project. It is, like I said, a new version every 2 weeks, but it is not ready for production yet. Glad you like it. Any questions before we move on to the next example? Okay, so what I did in this case, if you recall, let me just collapse things so you can get a bird's eye view. We just created some static files that we just sent down to the browser, and all our interaction was done in the browser. There wasn't any response or any sending back to the server, right, except for that JSON file. So now, if you were to go through and create a new project, again, we're going to select core and click OK. And now we have .NET Core and .NET Core 2.1. And now we're going to select the Blazor with the hosted solution. Once you click OK, then it's going to go through and generate the file. So I'm just going to cancel that because I already have one created. And what it's going to do is it's going to create a project with three different, or a solution rather, with three different projects. So I call this Blazor Demo Hosted for the solution. And so it created a Blazor Demo Hosted client, a Blazor Demo Hosted.server, and a Blazor Demo Hosted.shared. And as you might have guessed, the client side contains what? Client side code. The server contains the server side code. And here it's lending itself to what we've done with MVC, where we have a controller in the controllers folder that essentially gets hit every time we make a call. And now we have the ability to interact with a shared project that can be used in both the client and the server. So we can have code that's leveraged by both and put it in the shared project. And in this case, we just have the code for the weather forecast. So when I run this, granted it's three separate projects in one solution, and again, there's our familiar friend, right? Where we have a single page, we have a home, we have a counter, and then we have a fetch data. So where this is different, as you have just seen, I hit a breakpoint here. Where this is different is that it's no longer running everything client-side, but rather I am now having server-side interaction like I do with my MVC applications. So in my controller, called sample data controller, I have a function called weather forecasts, and if you notice when I click on the weather forecasts, it hit that method, and there I have my breakpoint, and I'm able to step through the code and then monitor things, and then eventually what this is doing is it's retrieving the weather forecast, and it's rendering it on the browser. So this is done through an API call, and now because I have separate code, my server side versus my client side, I am now able to see the three separate projects and can step through the controller as I make the call into the weather forecasts. When I go into the counter, again, I'm able to update my counter and you don't see a page flicker here. When we look at the code, we're going to go over to the client side, pages, counter.cshtml, and there is that familiar code that's running in this function block. So this function block is considered a component. The entire page is also considered a component. These are reusable components, essentially. And as we had seen in the previous example, I'm able to leverage them and reuse them. I can also parameterize them, as we had seen in this example, where I can pass in a title here to the survey prompt, or I can just leave it blank and then just utilize whatever title is being used.
I mean, you can put web UI components in the data now with this DLL.
Right. Everything is building down to a DLL. Also, when I run it, let's go to inspect. How many CSHTML files do you see here? How many HTML files do you see?
Just on the deck coming in here. One page, right?
Everything is going to a DLL. And then I create my WASM file. There's my mono.wasm. The reason they call it mono is because they're piggybacking on what the Xamarin team had done with the mono project. And so they utilize that. That's why it has the name of mono.wasm.
So these DLLs, they just reside on the server, and they're serving those? Or
so in this specific example, the second example, it's both. There are files that are being sent down to the client. What you're looking at here is all browser side.
Okay.
What got sent to the client. But I also have a web API call that I call. And so when I go into my weather forecasts, fetch data, boom, there's my controller on the server side, and it inherits from class controller, and it's being called when it's trying to retrieve the data. So in this example, I have both server side and client side.
I'm really ignorant as far as .NET goes, but so those DLL files are being pushed up to the client's browser. browser and they reside in there, you know?
The client gets the DLLs that it needs, and then the others remain on the server side. And again, that's dependent on the project itself.
Okay, and so it is like a single page application, though, right?
In this case, yeah, it was set up as a single page.
Okay, okay. And is there any like routing that you have to manually do, or is it just picking up those classes?
I'm sorry?
Like, you have to set up routing, like manually, like, so when you click counter and you see the URL in the, you know, it's your app slash counter?
Yeah.
Are you having to configure those routes manually, or is that just picking up from the...
So you configure it by specifying the page directive.
That's it.
Wow, that's it.
The route. So it's just picking up from that.
Right. And if you recall in a previous example, I played around with a file name, I called it counter.xyz.cshtml, and because I left the route name the same, it got picked up.
Yeah. And so when you render like the survey one, in that other example, and you put that survey tag, that's just pulling from, you know, that other component.
So that was a reusable component, and I was able to reuse it in multiple places, so my survey prompt, I got way too many files open here. Yeah, here we go. So the survey prompt.
There's a
survey prompt.cshtml that's described here, and so it leverages that.
Oh, okay. And so that's not, so the application at the top.
I'm sorry?
So I was trying to figure out
file name.
Yeah, just the file name. And
right.
Cool.
So for the survey prompt, that is under the share folder here, and that's, again, because it's used by multiple components. You had a question, Pam?
I thought this was specifically developed for SBA.
SBA?
Yeah, I thought that's what Blazor did.
Would you ever use Blazor for not a single page app? Or is that typically what you would use it for? So that you're not actually having separate page loads and going to different, well, you are going to different URLs, but all within that one
script. I'm sorry?
No, that's where JavaScript comes in.
Okay, so with single page apps, so with this one, with this specific example, everything was static here, right? But in this example where I have three projects, I had things hitting the server from the client. So it's broken out that way separately. It's not a single page because, again, I'm changing and I'm going to different routes as opposed to swapping out components inside of a page. I mean, you could argue that there is no page flicker, but again, everything is done by the binary that's being sent to the browser. So it's not a single page app in the sense that I'm not swapping out single components, but rather it appears to be a SPA because of the quickness of it.
Yeah, I mean, it's all that one index file that has that app tag in it, right?
Well, right, but...
Yeah, the browser's never doing it yet.
So I'm not, but then again, I'm not browsing to a .cshtml.
Yeah, you're not actually ever changing
right?
the page again.
But I am changing the route.
Yeah, but I mean, Angular does that too.
Yeah,
all
React.
Angular,
React,
probably. Alright, so I guess it's all
depends
on how you define it.
Yeah, it's blurring the lines.
Right.
It's not
into the user,
so it's, yeah.
Same effect, so it appears.
Yeah.
Yeah. I mean, yeah, that's the bonus.
That's the bottom line.
Is that fast, you know, response for the user and just being able to reuse components and have them.
But again, it was quick because there's two examples that I worked with. One was static, and the second one was I had server responses, so it all depends on how you set it up.
Yeah, so your first example, like, you don't need web server hosting at all. Like, you can just dump those on a file hosting bucket and it'll all
exactly.
Set. Yeah.
Yep.
So what's the variable current count and the counter CSHTML file being on the client side? If the server wanted that value, could it access it in its current form, or how would that be achieved?
So you're talking about this current count, and we want to be able to access it in the server side, let's say inside this controller?
Sure.
Okay, so I would say you would have to use something like a view bag to pass it back and leverage arrange it that way, because where is this counter running?
On the client.
On the client, right.
A view bag?
View bag.
View bag.
Right.
Thank you.
Yes, sir.
So is there any like passing of, like some React and I think any other state, so like passing state between those reusable components? Like where they can communicate with each other and?
You can.
But what's the shared project do? That's what I assumed was done for.
So the shared. That just has the weatherforecast.cs, which is just the defining class here. And so this code is leveraged in both the controller as well as in the client side under fetch data.
That's nice. Now you have your class definition in one place.
Right.
Client answer.
Right.
That's always a hassle of TypeScript that have a C# class and a TypeScript class the same shape.
And you always have to make sure they're always make sure
right.
They're in sync.
Change one. Okay. And you mess up.
Right.
That's cool.
Until it gets into production, and then you find out the hard way. to answer your question, sir, about the state,
it's still pretty new.
Well, I mean, aside from the new, I would venture to say that it works a lot like MVC, because it's MVC-esque in the sense that I'm utilizing a controller, and I can also add in other controllers and views, and then it works with the postback as I'm making changes.
Right.
So what's the difference between this and MVC?
MVC?
Mm-hmm.
Okay. So with MVC, what would compile down to? And what do we have to deploy to our servers?
Well, it would be C#.
I build it in C#. Right?
Right. I'm not really familiar with C.
ASP.NET. So for those that have worked with MVC, when we create our MVC app, what do we deploy?
DLLs.
DLLs? What else? You gotta have the framework installed on the server, true. What else?
JavaScript.
CSS, HTML, CSS, all that jazz. I gotta deploy that out to my server, right? What did I deploy here? What got deployed to the client?
Machine code.
Right? A WASM file, and then it compiled all the DLLs and sent them to the browser.
So this could theoretically take place of ASP.NET?
Theoretically, but we talked about that previously. I see ASP.NET still being supported for a long time to come, simply because there's a lot of code out there that needs that support. It's the same reason why web forms have not completely disappeared either. There's just a lot of code investment out there.
So technically, I mean, so by a broader definition of MVC, like in full stack JavaScript, we have MVC and it's the DLL files that we're working with or anything. It's just, there just has to be a model of view and controller. But this has all that. I mean, your pages are pretty much, the front end of your view.
But the model view controller, so. If you recall, that's basically my programming paradigm, right? What gets deployed essentially are DLLs, CSHTMLs, and all the other file types we discussed. So here, it's not like that. I'm deploying, as you had seen, a lot of DLLs, a couple standard WASM files, I'm sorry, one WASM file and a couple standard JS files that all get built for me. I am doing nothing but C# code.
Your server app here, that's just the standard ASP.NET MVC project, right?
This one?
Yeah, your Blazor demo hosted up server?
Yeah.
That doesn't really have anything to do with Blazor, right?
It does.
Oh, I thought that's just a regular MVC
no.
server side.
But you can add in controller in the server side. So if I go into my server and I go into my controller, I can say and let's completely stop the solution here.
Oh, because you can put a razor view in here too.
Right. So now I can add in a new item. So I can add in the razor views as needed in ASP.NET Core. But what I wanted to show you really, so here I can add in my razor views and a razor page. But what I really wanted to show you wasn't here. I can add a scaffolded item, so now I can do a controller using read-write actions, and I would have to add the pages into it. And I can also leverage EF. So I can add in another controller. Let's do this one. And we'll call it default controller. Anything Microsoft integrates beautifully with anything else Microsoft has.
So should be the case. I mean, if it didn't, then I would highly question.
Yeah. SharePoint is kind of like the black sheep of that family, right?
Yeah, this is just standard MVC, right? I mean, this is a.
So now, yeah, right. I added in my default controller. It inherits from the controller class.
This is just ASP.NET for MVC, right? I mean, this doesn't even replace it.
Right. And then in addition, I also, but this is server side that I added it to, right? Not client side.
Yeah.
And so it is no different than the sample data controller up here that also inherits from my controller class, except this one I added a raw for API/controller. But essentially, this inherits from the controller class as well.
So when would you do this boosted option instead of the first example that you did? What would be the thing that would push you to go that route?
If you need to have an interaction with your user, get data, submit it to the database, and then present them with new data, that would be the scenario, versus a more static or something that just lives in the browser, so to speak.
The first example, that weather data, where was that residing?
That was a JSON file that we got through.
You packaged it down and bind it right here.
Server-side project type is still a console app, right?
The server-side project type, so if we look at that.
What folder there?
That is a console application. And if we look at the client, that will also be a console application. And then if we look at the hosted, or the shared solution rather, that will just be a class library. Okay, it's 8:08. I'm open to having any additional questions, but I don't want to keep you over longer than you intended.
So is it the WASM next file that's generating the server goes across the line to the browser?
It's the .wasm file that does get generated and sent over the wire, yes.
So you pre-compile everything and put it up?
Right, so when I hit the play button, all my C# code is now converted into a DLL, and it generates a WASM file that calls that DLL along with what